Good afternoon. Thank you all for joining us today at this media briefing about crisis standards of care and COVID-19 in Idaho. My name is Kelly Petroff and I'll be moderating today. Please note that everyone should be muted unless you are speaking. ASL interpretation is available today. Search for ASL interpreter and hover over the three little dots in the window to lock it in place. DHW's director, Dave Jepson, will provide opening remarks along with Dr. Jim Souza from St. Luke's and Dr. Patrice Burgess from St. Alphonsus. Elkisha Tulloch, the division administrator for the Division of Public Health, and Dr. Christine Hahn, the state epidemiologist, are also available today to answer questions. With that, I'll turn it over to the director, Jepson.
Well, thank you, Kelly, and welcome everyone to our press briefing today. Today, I am making the declaration that crisis standards of care are deactivated for all public health districts except the Panhandle Health District. This means that crisis standards of care remain in effect for the Panhandle Health District, which encompasses Boundary, Bonner, Kootenai, Benoit, and Shoshone counties. For the rest of the state, while crisis standards of care are deactivated, healthcare systems are generally using contingency operations. Since entering crisis standards of care on September 6th, the situation across the state has been monitored daily. The process to deactivate crisis standards of care began when hospital admissions started declining and when healthcare systems started individually indicating that they had moved to contingency operations instead of operating under crisis standards of care conditions. As a result, I convened the Crisis Standards of Care Activation Advisory Committee on last Friday, November 19th, to review the situation at healthcare facilities across the state. The committee determined that, except for the healthcare systems in the Panhandle Health District, healthcare systems had moved to contingency operations, and several healthcare systems had recently made carefully considered decisions to exit operating under crisis standards of care and moved to contingency operations. The committee recommended that crisis standards of care be deactivated in all public health districts except for the Panhandle Health District, where COVID-19 case numbers and hospitalizations continue to exceed the healthcare resources available. I have accepted the committee's recommendation and today make the declaration that crisis standards of care are deactivated for all public health districts except the Panhandle Health District. Crisis standards of care was a decision that all of us were hoping to avoid. It's a decision of last resort. With crisis standards of care being in place across the state for more than 2 months now, it has been a difficult situation. And unfortunately, that remains the situation in North Idaho. Moving out of crisis standards of care for most of the state is an indication that COVID case and hospitalization numbers in Idaho are headed the right direction. However, hospitals are generally working in contingency operations, which means that they remain stressed with an unusually high number of patients. As a result, the state will continue to provide and arrange resources, including healthcare personnel via FEMA and existing federal contracts until the situation further stabilizes. It will be some time before healthcare systems return to full normal operations. It will also take time for the healthcare systems to work through the many delayed surgeries and other medical treatments. I want to provide a word of caution. We see that in some parts of the country, including states close by, COVID cases have started to climb again, which means it is important that we all continue to do our part to help out North Idaho to come out of crisis standards of care and to keep the rest of the state out of crisis standards of care. I strongly encourage everyone to choose to get vaccinated. It is not too late to start. And I encourage everyone who is already vaccinated and eligible to get a booster shot. Finally, on this Thanksgiving week, I want to express my appreciation and gratitude to all the healthcare and public health workers in Idaho, including those who are helping out temporarily as part of our federal contracts. I also want to express my gratitude to the men and women of the Idaho National Guard who have been providing staffing support during crisis standards of care activation. To all of you, thank you for what you have done and continue to do to make sure that everyone in Idaho can receive the healthcare that they need. And with that, I will hand it over to Dr. Souza.
Hey, thanks, Director Jepson. And thanks to everybody in the media for being with us today. I wanted to make comments around four areas. First, explaining why we communicated that we were no longer operating in crisis. Second, I'd like to talk a little bit about how we're thinking about the near-term future. Third, what things we're doing to support our people and to support patient care. And then I also have a few words of gratitude I'd really love to share. In terms of why we communicated that we are no longer in a crisis position, I'll enumerate a few of the facts that drove that. All of our surge units have now been closed. That means special units that we opened up in order to manage critically ill COVID patients, those have all been closed. We actually have capacity in our intensive care units. We are still having to do some load leveling from site to site, but we've got capacity. We've been able to resume some of our non-emergent surgery, and we've been ramping that up. Staff that was redeployed from, you know, their home unit to the bedside on a med-surg unit or in the intensive care units, they've been redeployed back to their home units. We are starting to accommodate and actually encourage our staff to take much-needed time away. Our staffing ratios are back to normal. Our supplies are stable. And then on our collaborative calls across the state with other providers, we're not seeing the need for real-time load leveling site to site in this part of the state. So those are the reasons why we communicated that we were no longer in a crisis position. In terms of how we're thinking about the near-term future, I want to share that we are not sharing a mission accomplished message. We don't believe this will be our last surge of COVID. We hope it's the worst one. I think all you need to do is look to North Idaho to have insight into how volatile the situation remains. Or you could look at what's coming out of Western Europe, the Eastern Seaboard, or now some of these hot spots like Michigan with early influenza outbreaks. To be clear, we're still in a contingency position. We are very busy. Today, 21% of our adult hospitalizations in our healthcare system are COVID. So 1/5 of our adult admissions with one diagnosis. And in the intensive care unit, it's more acute. It's 40%. So it's not mission accomplished. Instead, this is a moment, we think, where we can collect ourselves, reflect on the innovations that we implemented, the things that we've learned, and pivot looking forward to how we're going to stop history from repeating itself by making wise decisions. So to that end, you know, the way we're thinking about this in running our own business is to use the data that we have, case rates, whether or not there's a new variant in the community, vaccination rates, access to vaccines, access to effective treatments, to inform our own business practices in terms of how we conduct ourselves here. And that means, you know, travel policies and mask policies and meeting policies and so on and so forth. And as we head into the holidays this year, when I think the public and businesses have more visibility to things that can mitigate the next surge, like knowing who in the immediate family is vaccinated, who's not, who's vulnerable, who's not, that in the same way as we're applying those data points to manage our business, we're hoping that businesses and the public do the same. Jump into our people and our patients. We're pulling out the stops to the degree we can to support our people, some of whom have been through a lot, some of whom, frankly, have experienced trauma. Right? They've seen a lot, they've managed a lot, they've managed a lot of suffering and dying. So whether it's, you know, critical incident stress management or psychological first aid or opportunities for, you know, open forums to just call in, peer-to-peer opportunities, we want to do all of that. And we also think it's important that we mark this moment in time where we honor what was done, reflect on what we learned, and then use that to, again, pivot to the future and avoid repeating the past. For our patients, we have a lot of backlogged care. I think the place it's easiest to quantify that is probably in the surgical realm. We have about 7,000 to 8,000 cases that were not scheduled or delayed due to this surge and the need to redeploy those teams and that staff to meet the needs of acutely ill and critically ill COVID patients. For a sense of scale, we do around 50,000 surgical cases a year in our healthcare system. So you do the math, you know that we've got a 15 to 20% backlog. Working through that is going to be a logistical challenge that's going to play forward into our near-term future. If we ran our operating rooms at 120%, right? We staffed them up. We ran them on weekends. We ran them longer into the days and evenings. Even if we did that, we're going to need, right, additional staffing, travelers, and whatnot. And it would take us about 6 months to work through that backlog. Today, we are open again to, we're starting to move through total joints and spine surgeries. All cancer surgery in our system is live again. And other surgical procedures. The last comments I'd like to make, Director Jepson, are gratitude. I'd like to express gratitude for the other healthcare systems in Idaho, St. Alphonsus, Kootenai, Eastern Idaho Regional Medical Center, Portneuf, all the critical access hospitals and our partners at the state. I'd like to note that we managed through this period of crisis standards thus far in our portion of the state without having to make a this for that care decision. Meaning we didn't have to say there's one ventilator and two patients and make that allocation decision or a deallocation decision. We didn't have to do that. And not discounting a component of luck in that, I think the real thanks should go to the healthcare providers in the state who innovated and collaborated and applied an incredible amount of ingenuity in terms of where we take care of patients, who we take care of them with, and how we take care of them, so that at the end of the day, we all went with a little bit less together so that we didn't have to make a decision like that. So thanks to them. I also want to I'm thankful for the thousands of patients whose lives our healthcare delivery systems have saved. I know we all look at the death statistics and we focus on that, but thousands and thousands were saved through the efforts of healthcare workers. And then that's my last gratitude is to the doctors, nurses, therapists, and literally everyone who is behind them and supporting them in their work. The collective human effort that they pulled off in Idaho over the past 5 months is nothing short of remarkable. So thank you. I'll turn it to my colleague, Dr. Burgess.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sousa. Very well said. And I would like to, you know, echo many of your comments, and also our hearts go out to North Idaho, where they're still really struggling, and also other parts of our country, as you mentioned, and in Europe as well. I just want to point out how dramatic crisis standards of care has been, even though we didn't have to get into the situation that Dr. Sousa described, where we truly had to ration care. We definitely were providing care in non-traditional areas, much as they still are in North Idaho. And we had to bring in people from outpatient clinics to come in and help in the hospital. And we had to have our nurse-patient ratios were different, taking care of sicker patients on the floor that used to be in the ICU. And all of that, you know, has been pretty remarkable for all of us. And again, very stressful to all of the healthcare workers and to the patients as well. We also know we have a backlog of patients that maybe should have been getting care, but have been maybe frightened or delaying care because they didn't want to go into a environment where they knew that there were a lot of COVID patients. So we know even mammograms and colonoscopies and a lot of preventive care that normally happens, is there's a little bit of a backlog of that. And once that resumes, we'll discover people that need surgeries for, you know, things that are discovered when they resume their preventive care. So we're preparing for that as well. I do want to also mention, with the holidays approaching, again, to reiterate the things that people can do to help keep us out of crisis standards of care. And the most dramatic thing is the vaccination. We know for a fact that these vaccines are safe, and we know that they keep people from being seriously ill, being in the hospital, and dying from COVID. There's just no doubt about that. It's a scientifically proven fact. And if you've been waiting and you think maybe it's too late, it's not too late to get vaccinated. Even though it takes 2 weeks for the full immunity to develop, there is still immunity that develops in those first couple of weeks that is helpful. And if you have been vaccinated and you meet the criteria, if it's been 6 months after your Moderna or Pfizer vaccine or 2 months after your Johnson & Johnson vaccine, we encourage to get a booster. We know that the immunity from the vaccine starts to wane at about 7 months, and plus the Delta variant has been very much more contagious. So getting that booster helps bolster up your immunity as we enter into the holiday season. We know that we expect there's going to be more travel during the holidays, and we understand that people are tired of restrictions. So please use caution with masking, hand washing, all the other things that we know that can keep people safe. And monitor your gatherings and try to make sure that they are appropriately distanced, or at least you know that folks are vaccinated and that you yourself are vaccinated, so that we can stay out of crisis standards of care and not go right back into them. I think we all remember that little window of excitement back in July, right before the Delta variant came, when we had that time frame when we said that vaccinated people didn't have to wear a mask in the grocery store, at the hospitals. We were starting to feel that maybe we were coming out of this, and then it was just devastating to have to go back into another surge for all of us, for the public as well as for the hospitals. So we are really pleading with everyone to do their part so that we don't have this momentary relief and then go right back into a bad situation again. I also want to just say that we are here for you, healthcare workers. We are tired and we have been through a lot, but we also are here to take care of non-COVID things as well. And we don't want anyone to delay care because they're afraid that the hospital is not able to take care of them, or because there's an infection risk. We have become incredibly good at screening, masking, all of the prevention things that we are doing to keep our hospitals and clinics safe. And we are definitely here for you, and we do not want you to delay your care. It's heartbreaking to us if somebody had something that they could have been prevented and they didn't come in for a heart problem or any number of things. So that's my other plea. And I would like to echo Dr. Seuss's gratefulness for the cooperation with the health system. It's been unprecedented. We are on calls all the time where we are switching patients back and forth based on who has a bed available. And it's just been so heartwarming across the entire state that, as he said, we've been able to avoid rationing care because we've been able to move somebody from one area to another and make sure that they got what they needed. And then I guess the last thing I'd like to mention is contingency care means that we are still under some stress. So we still have quite a few traveling staff helping us out, as well as the FEMA and National Guard that was mentioned. And we are not quite back to normal, but we are certainly better off than we were during the crisis standards of care time frame. And we certainly hope to continue to improve and someday perhaps be back to normal and maybe even not be wearing a mask. That would be really exciting. Our test positivity rate is one of the things that we look at for that, as well as our cases per 100,000. At the peak of this surge, we were seeing about 25% of our COVID tests positive, which is quite high. We know if they're below 5%, we start to feel like maybe we're out of the woods as far as being a rapid spread. We're right around 9% right now, but as Dr. Sousa said, we're seeing in Michigan bumping back up to 16%. So that's one of the many measures that we look at to decide when we can start relaxing some of our precautions around masking, visitation, and those types of things. So with that, I think I'll turn it over to questions. Thank you very much.
I'll now take questions from media participants. Please raise your hand in WebEx, or type your question into the chat area. When I say your name, please unmute yourself and announce your name and media outlet before asking your question. And please remember to clear your hand when you are done. First hand I see up is Audrey Dutton.
Hi, Audrey Dutton from the Idaho Capital Sun. This question is for Dr. Sousa. Last week I asked the director, you know, if he was able to kind of tell us what the longer term effects are going to be of having to postpone these surgeries and things like that. And just in general, what are the long term kind of effects that you foresee of what we've gone through over the past 2 years in terms of healthcare delivery and the kinds of things that you're expecting to see?
Okay, yeah, thank you, Audrey, for that question. It's really worrisome is the short story. We expect to see a surge in suboptimally managed chronic disease. We talked about that earlier in the summer when I think all the health systems in the state were experiencing this somewhat unusual multi-diagnosis increase in hospital admissions, and our internal data showed us that a significant amount of that, not all of it, but a significant amount of it was acute exacerbations of chronic disorders. So we expect there to be some of that. Some of that may also be related to unmet surgical demands. We also expect, well, let me say it this way. This doesn't have to happen. I want everybody to recall that in the winter, fall and winter of 2020, we had a complete nothing burger of a winter viral scene, right? Flu, RSV. Now, they came roaring back, or RSV did, in the summer. We had an RSV summer outbreak that inundated our children's hospital. That could happen again, especially if folks internalized a message that we're out of crisis with everything's okay. So I'm going to double down on the message, please, that this is not mission accomplished. This is still let's use what we've learned to not just do what we did before and expect a different outcome. The other two things I'd comment on, Audrey, are the black cloud that went with this pandemic that we noticed in our internal data sets were increases in behavioral health diagnoses on discharge summaries, so depression, anxiety. Some of that may have been that those conditions weren't managed well. Some of those may have been new diagnoses that happened. But the point is, if you're depressed, you probably won't manage your other health conditions well. So too, we also saw an increase in substance use presentations to emergency departments, either for intoxication or for withdrawal. And that kind of black cloud of behavioral health and substance use disorders that traveled with the pandemic is really concerning for, you know, the the surge that we think we're going to need to continue to manage of unmet population health needs. Hope that answered your question.
Thank you, Audrey.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Audrey. Next question will come from Melissa Dablin.
Hi, Melissa Dablin with Idaho Public Television. This question is for Dr. Burgess and Dr. Souza. Understanding that we're still in contingency standards of care and we're not at mission accomplished, and also understanding that there's always the threat of other variants, as we saw recently, do you see a point in the medium term future, let's say in the next 5 or 6 years, where you two feel like your shoulders can relax, where you think that, okay, maybe we're going to be okay, or is this going to be your new normal?
Thanks, Melissa. I'm going to have Dr. Burgess start with the response and then send it over to Dr. Souza.
Yeah, I think you might predict that I would say if we could get our vaccination rates up, if we had gotten our vaccination rates up, we wouldn't be where we are today. If we had had a significant number of our population vaccinated before the Delta variant arrived, we probably wouldn't have seen the degree of surge that we saw, you know, and so, but we can't fix that, but we can go moving forward. And we have the technology to adapt vaccines as we see variants develop. So it's really a matter of our ability to get a significant portion of our population vaccinated, and then also our ability to adhere to the other precautions that we know work as well. So that's what I see as our way out of this, and it's been hard to watch the polarization around some of these measures that are really just basic science. And I do see a time, and you look back to 1918, I think it was about 3 years before they were fully out of the pandemic. So I had hoped we would beat that with our technology, but I think there is a light at the end of the tunnel. I don't yet know exactly when that is, but I do think we'll get there.
I'll just double down on what Dr. Burgess said about vaccination, and then I'll admit that probably 6 months ago, I threw away my crystal ball when asked that question about, you know, predicting, especially that far into the future. Oh my gosh, I just don't know. I think we are, I'll say that we are all starting to think about what it might look like to manage endemic COVID. Not epidemic and pandemic, but endemic, where it's part of what we manage, whether it's seasonal or year-round. I think we're all starting to wrap our heads around that, and emphasizing a point Dr. Burgess also just made, we're telling ourselves that the way we'll do that is, you know, use the science and use what we know works. There might be times a year where we're more cautious, times a year where we let up.
Sure, and I guess to put a finer point on it, are you optimistic that people are going to start paying attention to the science now that we are past Delta, this particular Delta surge?
Dr. Burgess.
Yeah, it's hard to say what will help people appreciate and feel comfortable with the science. I was just looking at, someone had reminded me of some statistics about how many deaths we've had in the country from COVID. And when 9/11 happened, you know, we lost over 2,000 people in one day. We're losing about that many every 2 or 3 days to COVID. But we're not experiencing the same outrage that we experienced for a variety of reasons. But I think people hopefully will start to really see the actual impact of this, not only on the healthcare systems, but on our population. I know it's probably hard to find somebody that hasn't been touched by this, either in their own family or in their extended family. And we just need folks to understand that we are now dealing with a preventable illness, or at least preventable to be in the hospital and die from it. And that's my hope, that people will continue to recognize that and take the measures that they need to take.
Thank you.
Our next question will come from Ian May.
Hello, this is Ian Smay with CREM2 News. My question is for Director Jepson and Dr. Sousa, is there any estimated timeline for when the Panhandle Health District might be able to deactivate crisis standards of care?
Thanks, Ian. Director?
Yes, thanks, Ian. It's a great question. You know, I will give the answer I've been giving through this entire crisis standards of care situation, which is it'll depend on the conditions on the ground and what's actually happening there, particularly with the main health system there of Kootenai Health. What we know today is that the numbers in North Idaho are headed the right direction, meaning that testing positivity or the percent of tests given that show a positive result for COVID are declining in North Idaho. The number of cases are declining and the number of patients in the hospital is declining. So if that trend continues, I would expect sometime in the near future that whatever that may be, we'll reach a point where the demand for healthcare resources is below the supply of healthcare resources and we can move out of crisis standards of care. But I do know that Kootenai Health is still pretty stretched. I don't want to speak for them, but I do know that they are not in the same situation that the rest of the hospitals are around the state. And we continue to be in daily contact with them and the rest of the hospitals around the state to see A, how we can help out, and B, just to monitor the situation for what assistance they need. So I'm not in a place where I can give a time frame. I can just say that if the current trends continue, we would expect that in the near future.
Okay, the next question will come from
Hi, I think my question was for Dr. Hahn. It was pretty similar to Ian's question. I forgot to say where I was. I'm from Spokane Public Radio. When it comes to, cases in the state as far as circulation and case rate spread right now, and when we dive into North Idaho, when we say it's declining, how is it compared to, the last, I've heard kind of over and over again that our surge is, it's still above what we had in December of last year. And, the low is still higher than that. And so I was curious when it comes to spread and spikes, if we're in North Idaho still kind of where we were in previous surges, even though it's declining.
Thanks, Rebecca, for the question. And Dr. Hahn, do you want to address that?
Yeah, thank you. Can you guys hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, thank you, Rebecca. First of all, I hope that you do look at our website because we have the trends by county, so you can really kind of see it, and it's quite interesting. As you know, the state is not completely homogeneous. That's one reason why we're in the situation we are now. County rates have come down significantly in Kootenai County, but they're still holding kind of high in Bonner County, for example. So it's not uniform. The further you break it down, you see these different trends. And if you look at Idaho as a whole, we've been feeling like, wow, things are looking great. They're coming down. But we've just hit where we're just about at the national average. As you know, the national rate numbers, as the director alluded to, have been going up. And we've kind of now met we're concerned that our downward trajectory won't continue. I think the director also mentioned that some of our neighboring states are seeing increasing numbers. So we're very worried about that, and that we are going to start seeing a reversal of the good numbers that we've seen over the last several weeks. To speak to your question more precisely, if you don't have that link, I can throw it in the chat, but you can go in county by county and you can see the trends per 100,000 population. Looking at it right now, you can see, for example, as I mentioned in Kootenai County, that it's really come down nicely from over 80 per 100,000 to now closer to 40 or so. That's decreased by half, which is a dramatic decrease. So it's not a minor thing, especially with the large population there and nearby where you are. So I'll throw that in the chat and just go to the tab cases by county. And you can see the counties near you. So just to sum up, as the director said, we're very encouraged by the decreasing numbers in our state, but we realize we're not where we need to be. We want to see numbers continue to decrease, and we're very concerned going into the holiday season that we're set up for a reversal of the good things that have been happening lately.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Right. Going back to Audrey Denton, did you have another question, Audrey?
Yes, thank you. My question is for Dr. Burgess. You mentioned the shift in guidance on masking over the summer, and I wondered what your thoughts are on the public's, you know, that's come up quite a bit, CDC guidance on masking, and now the confusion about boosters, who's eligible, who should get it. What do you make of kind of where we're at in terms of the public skepticism and confusion about whom to trust when it comes to public health advice like that? And what's kind of the path out of that confusion and skepticism?
Well, I think that's actually just the way science works. You know, as we learn, we adapt and we continue to change recommendations. The public just probably hasn't been exposed to that as much because this is all new. This pandemic is all of our first pandemic. We weren't around for the 1918 one, at least most of us weren't. And so we are learning as we go as far as what the right thing to do is at that moment. I think that was the right thing to do in July. In July, our numbers were down and we did have a good vaccination rate and we did not have the Delta variant yet. And so releasing some of those mask requirements for vaccinated individuals was the right thing to do. But then as the data changed, just like any good scientist, we had to change our approach to match that data. And I think that's where the public needs to kind of become comfortable that recommendations change on purpose. Just like this reminds me so much of HIV. When I was in medical school, HIV was just coming out and we were learning about HIV and we were having to adapt. At first, we wore so much protection when we were with an HIV patient because we were so concerned about transmission. And then later we realized that it wasn't as easily transmitted as we thought. So there's lots of examples of other disease processes and other scientific discoveries that you learn as you go and you continue to adapt as you catch up to what's going on. But I don't think it was wrong at all to relax those restrictions at that moment in time. But we are in a different place now, and we have the Delta variant among us. Even though if you're vaccinated, we do know that you can still be susceptible to it. Just you would not get seriously ill and be very unlikely to go to the hospital or die. But it would still be better to wear your mask and not get that when you're in a situation where you're around crowds of people, especially that you don't know the vaccination status of. So I think hopefully the public will start to continue to learn and read about how the scientific process works and how we've dealt with other diseases as we're learning more about them and understand that this is perfectly normal to continue to adapt recommendations as we go.
Thank you.
Melissa Bevan, do you have another question?
I do. This is, I think, for Dr. Souza. I was wondering if you could give us an update on the delay of the vaccine requirement for St. Luke's employees. Is there a new deadline? Has that delay been lifted?
Yes. Now that we are moving out of crisis, we will begin implementing both our influenza vaccine requirement and our COVID vaccine requirement. So, you know, today we have almost 17,000 employees and we have a fraction of a percent, it's 0.6% that are non-compliant, meaning they either have not gotten a vaccine or have not been granted an exemption. So pretty small number, but we're moving forward with implementing that now.
Thank you. And so just to make sure that I have this accurate, that deadline is basically now, then you're moving forward.
We are beginning, the deadline isn't now, but we are beginning the communication with staff who are non-compliant, that you're non-compliant and we need you to comply. And the period of time within which they're going to have to, you know, take an action is on the order of a couple of weeks.
Okay. And thank you so much. One last question. Can you give us an idea of about how many exemptions have been granted?
It's a ballpark around 8%, 9%.
Sorry, to clarify.
I would love to get someone from my team to confirm and validate that rather than hanging on that number. But let me say it to you this way. We have had fairly wide guardrails around our exemption process. We have honored people's requests for religious exemptions when those have come up. Medical exemptions are quite a bit tighter.
And I just want to ask one more clarifying question. I'm so sorry. When you say 8 to 9%, understanding that's ballpark, is that 8 to 9% of requests that have been made you have granted, or 8 to 9% of employees have, total employees have received exemptions?
Of total employees.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Rebecca White, do you have another question?
I do not. Sorry, I need to figure out how to unraise my hand.
Okay, thanks. So, I do not see any more questions. Give you a second here if anyone wants to raise their hand or ask a question. Okay, still not seeing any. So, seeing that we don't have any more questions, we're going to wrap up for today. We'll plan another media briefing next week on Tuesday, November 30th at 2:30 p.m. Thanks, everyone, for joining us today, and we wish you all a safe and happy Thanksgiving.